Shalom Aleichem and welcome to Online Smicha. Today we'll discuss halacha on this week's parsha, Parshas Matos. A lot of the dinim of kasher and kelim, tovel and kelim, we learn from this week's parsha, where the pasuk says, "Vayomer Elazar Kohen al Anshei Hatzava, Haboim lamelchama," and the Aaron Kohen, Elazar Kohen, says to those coming home from the war, and he says like this: "Aches Azov, Vesakasef, Vesanachoshes, Vesabarzel, all the goodies that you took home from the war, you have to kasher. Kol davar ashiyavoi ba'esh, taviru ba'esh." The process of kashering, anything that was used with fire, the way you do gil, not a gil kalim, the way you do hagala, is by putting it through the same heat temperature that it absorbed the taste of the goyim. And then v'toher. Further on, the pasuk says, v'chol ashiyavoi yavoi ba'esh, Any keli, as Rashi says, glasses, cups, or anything like that, which you usually don't use ba'esh with fire, the way you kasher it is ta'aviru b'mayim. You put it in water, which is the concept of tvila. Now, if you interesting to note is that if you look in the Torah Tmima, he has a shocking chakira. He says, "I want to understand what this tvila is all about. Is the tvila the end of the process of the kashering? Is it a form of kashering? Or the tevila is a different thing to just take away the tumas akum?" It's interesting that he's still debating it, and he came up with a chiddush, the hayos that we find, that you have to do tevila even on a new keli, that shows that it has nothing to do with kashering. It's just removing the reshus, the goyish tumah from the keli, and now it could enter reshus of a yid. But the pasuk, when the beginning of the pasuk describing this, it says haboim la milchama. It should be haboim mimilchama. As they're coming home, he tells them, "Hold on! Before you could use these kelim, there's a process of kashering." So the mefarshim say that this is actually on another halachic point. Perhaps that time of the war, there wasn't an issue of kashering, because we know the din is that eina ben yomai. Anything which absorbs taste of a non-kosher, and it's a tam pogum, it's a blemished taste because the taste already is there longer than a day, you really don't have to kasher it. So perhaps the din over there did not apply because it was longer, the kalim were a day later, and it was a tam pogum. So Elazar was actually talking for the future. He says, "Haboim l'mochama, let me tell you what should take place from now on. If ever there's a mochama, and you're getting kalim, and it will be a ben yoimoy, that's what you have to do." Others say that the expressions and the discussion over here of Elazar with the Anshei Hatzava was Elazar was not too happy with their enthusiasm, how they're coming back from the war, all excited that they have these things. That's what he was talking about. The Dinim HaGala is elaborated in Hilchas Pesach, Tafnun Aleph, Tafnun Beis. It's elaborated in parts of Basar B'Cholov and Hagolas Kalim and Yeridea too, but Tvilas Kalim is not that big of an issue. When you have to do what Kalim you have to, I mean, it's not a long discussion that people harav a lot. So let's talk about two nekudas about the concept of Tvilas Kalim, which we know now that the Tvilas Kalim has to be done even in a brand new Kali. There are two points I'd like to share with you. There is a machlokes between the Avnei Nezer and the Rogatchover, because we know that the Tevilas Kalim only takes place on a Kli Suda. Kli Suda means to say, if you look at the list of Kalim that the Pasuk describes here, it's all Kalim that you use on a meal, by a table in the meal. It's not any Kalim. So how do you define a Kli Suda? So the Avnei Nezer learns Pshat, that a kli suda means to say specifically a keli, which is for a suda, even if the guy made it not for a suda, the guy made it to sell, a guy made it to cut paper or wood with it, but if it's a kli suda, says the Avnei Nezer, it's a keli that has the chiyuv of tevila. Whereas the Ragachov, the Toughness Panayach, says he changes later his opinion. But originally the Toughness Panayach says that Rakim Akum Osazav Vuroi Lesuda. Perhaps only if the guy made this keli for a suda, then it has the din that you have to do tevilas kelim. If he would have made the keli l'schoira to sell, he compares it perhaps to the din of pas akum. By pas akum, we find that there's a difference between pas akum or pas nachtem, bread that he makes to sell. The iser of pas akum does not apply. So he says perhaps the same thing about tevila, but later. Even the Ragachov himself says if it was only a Kli Suda, you have to do the Tevila. Another Nekuda, there's a debate, there's a Machlekes, does there have to be any level of Kavana when you Tevil the Keli in the Mikveh? What happens if the Keli fell into the Mikveh? Or what happens if it was sent by a Katan? A Katan not necessarily has the right, knows what the Kavana. Or does he have to have kavanah while he does the tefillah in the mikvah? So, from what most of the poskim can believe, that a keli falls into the mikvah and you just take it out, there was no kavanah, the tefillah counts. Concerning a kid, it depends what part of it. A kid is allowed to do the ma'isa tefillah, but his nemanus for a kid to be trusted as a youngster and say, I did this and this, that's a problem. So you have to have somebody watching him because his koyach on the manus is not strong. But if a kid is able to do the tevila, the poskim say fine. The best would be if you teach him some level of kavana and tell him what he's doing by tovilin kelim, especially when he's tovilin more than one keli. Yashar koyach, please join us again next week.